All candidates for City Council District 2 were invited to the forum. And according to the guidelines, we have to have at least two of the three here to be able to continue on, which we do have. So please let me introduce the candidates alphabetically. Mr. Antonio Diaz and Mr. Keith Tony. So we will start with Mr. Diaz, who will have 2 minutes to give an opening statement. Our timer for today is going to be Tracy Ross Garcia. She will hold up a yellow card when they have 20 seconds remaining, and a red card when it's time to stop. And I would ask you, so that we can get as many questions as possible, to please stop at that point. So, Mr. Diaz, your opening statement.
Thank you. My name is Antonio Diaz, and I'm a lifelong resident of San Antonio, as well as being an indigenous person from this region as well. I'm a public administration. And it dawned on me when I sat here and I said to Keith, I graduated from St. Philip's 40 years ago.
Okay, All questions for this candidate forum will come from the moderator. There are 3x5 cards there. Please write out any questions that you have, and if you'll hold them up, we'll pick them up and get them up here. So that we can answer as many questions as possible, we will try and group similar questions together. We will rotate the questions so that each candidate has the opportunity to answer first and last. And before we start, I would like to welcome Mr. Oliver Hill, who is the president of the San Antonio Branch of NAACP. Thank you for being here. We will start the questioning with Mr. Diaz, and can you tell us, please, what are your top three priorities for District 2?
Well, I mentioned one already, is to have responsive representation in District 2. Second and third, I believe, are tied together. It's the economics and education. Some portions of District 2 are really, which are undergoing right now some revitalization and infusion of financing, as we all know. And the education opportunities also need to come. We've had St. Philip's for a very long time, and it needs to continue to be economically supported by our city, which would be my goal.
Thank you. Mr. Tony, 1 minute.
All right, we'll start with what I call my fraternal twins. The top two are employment and education. My goal is this, and you'll see it on some of my campaign literature. I don't see why you cannot stay in District 2 and go from a GED to a PhD and never have to leave District 2. And that's my goal, and that's, we can do that. We really can do that. It's about political will to get it done. The third one is infrastructure. Right around some places now after the rains, this is perfect timing. And just like I asked for a rainstorm just before this, so that I can make this point to you. There are places right now where there are 4, 5, and 6 inches of water standing at corners. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. When the city isn't including Hardberger Park for an additional $25 million for land. And we have water standing, and our children are walking through it to go to school. Our grandmothers and grandfathers are as well. So those are the three.
Thank you. This one will start with you, Mr. Tom.
Okay.
The East Side is a food desert. What are your plans to bring more healthy food options to the East Side?
Well, one of the things I intended to do when I was in office and never got an opportunity is to get a man who's very philanthropic, and I have nothing really negative to say about him, but I'd like to get Mr. Charles Butt to walk through the HEB at East Houston and New Braunfels Avenue with me and see if maybe it's just my nose from the Agent Orange, but it smells like warm blood in the meat department. So that has to go, first of all. We can work with the city, he can work with the city to expand that HEB. We need fresh fruits and vegetables. When I was in office, we brought in trucking tomato. And you hear the current councilman talk about the fact that he's so proud that he did that. He's too young to have a memory that short. We did that, we brought it in, and we're glad to do that. So we need to, another HEB, at least a larger one. And we can't depend on the one at McCreeless. It's easy for those of us who have vehicles, but many people ride buses to and from to get there. Some people just walk, you see them pulling the carts. So we need an additional food chain here.
Thank you. Mr. Diaz?
Well, I'm kind of partial to the HEB on Houston Street and then the office out there. So I don't know about the warm blood stuff. I'm glad it's still there. I would work with the White family to make sure it remains there and perhaps get expanded such as they did the one on the west side of the Eagles. If you've been there, it's wonderful. So we could negotiate with HEB to improve and get a little bit of But we also need a farmer's market in the area so that people can give us some fresh produce and stuff. We can do this. There's a lot of area in District 2 that is ripe for that, either just here in the area or throughout District 2. There's great room. So I don't consider it a food desert. I do think it needs some growth, and I'm sure the opportunity and possibilities are all here. I'd be willing to work with any business coming in to provide the services.
Thank you. For those of you standing in the back, there are plenty of seats up here in the front. I know it's like church, nobody wants to sit in front. Okay, Mr. Diaz, your 1 minute. What are your plans for public transportation?
Improving the via bus system. That transit system can be a model after the one they have in Houston. Instead of trying to get this light rail into our downtown area, which will benefit very few. It might benefit our tourism business, but it will not benefit the residents. So I would work with VIA. VIA had a program that was supposed to extend its hours and its route so that people could actually get further into areas they need to go, whether they're living there or to work. And that is where I would work with VIA. I think it's a very good transit system. It just needs to be expanded, the routes and the hours.
Thank you, Mr. Thomas.
I'm a practical guy, and I just don't think the streetcar rail system as proposed was practical. It really wasn't. It was an abbreviated route, so it would serve just a small population of folks, not most of us sitting in here. And so for that reason, I really was not for that. I'd like to see, however, a rail system like in Atlanta and other major cities, and we are a major city. We need to start acting like it. That would run from the airport straight downtown. So you get on that, you run right into, literally into the airport. Those of you who've been in Atlanta know what I'm talking about. You get on, you go into the airport. Why couldn't we have something like that? And I agree with Tony, expand VIA, get more routes. And I understand they have Wi-Fi now, that's a good thing. And understand this, more bike lanes. I'm of that generation where we can't wait to get in our cars and drive somewhere. But not my children and grandchildren, they don't want to. They want a bike. We need more bike lanes, safe bike lanes.
Thank you. We'll start with you, Mr. Chairman, for this next question. What is your position on the police bargaining process, particularly health care benefits?
My brother's a retired police officer, first of all, let me say that. And so I have great respect for police officers. And this is a little nuanced, and I ask you to please, if you are aware, if that's fine, if not, please check it out. We can't afford to lose our AAA bond rating as a city. This is important to us. It's important for funding and financing. So I don't think that we should necessarily be funding anyone, including council or anyone else, if your family members want to join a gym. I just don't see how we can afford to do that. We can't afford to maintain that. The way the contract is now is unsustainable. No matter where you fall on this thing, it truly is unsustainable. I think everyone needs to come to the table. When I was on council, I suggested we tamp down the rhetoric. We being both sides, the city and the unions, tamp down the rhetoric. That happened, and we got some movement. I'd like to see more movement, perhaps take personalities out of it. By that, I mean the president of the police union and also the city manager, back them out of it, have someone else be the principal negotiators.
Thank you, Mr. Diaz.
Well, in speaking to one of the city managers, Mr. Eric Walsh, who negotiates with the police officer association, he basically says, we go through this every time we have to negotiate a contract, and they haven't even gone past item 15 on that contract of association, and there's over 200 items in that contract. And it's been over 2 years they've been in negotiations. And that is because we have a very powerful, very well-financed police officer association. It's a machinery that basically elects our city representation, our city council mayor. They're financing all the campaigns. And so how is it that anyone can go against it? It's impossible. And I believe it engenders a conflict of interest when you can finance someone's campaign. And so they will not be able to negotiate for the people. They just negotiate for the benefits of that association. And I think we cannot continue to do this. We cannot continue to finance at the levels we finance. Otherwise, it will take all the city budget just for one service, which is the police service.
Thank you. Mr. Diaz, I'll start with you for this question. What do you plan to do to get high-performing high school students into elite higher education institutions?
Well, we need to look into being able to have the money. I mean, as we know, our school system is in jeopardy most of the time because of the way that it is funded, the public school system, through the property taxation. And if we raise our taxes so high that our residents cannot afford to pay the homes, then who do we depend on? I've been hearing a lot of grandfathering taxes for older people, but that is how we finance our public education. And a lot of our children suffer because of it, because then they cannot continue on. And locally, again, it's hard for the city to actually support education other than just some facelift or frills or something without really getting into it because of those problems of how our public school system is funded. We need to work on that very, very much.
Thank you. Mr. Chen?
Well, I spent 15 years on the school board, by the way. I spent 10 consecutive years as a school board president of Fort Sam Houston Independent School District. So a little bit about this. What you don't do is siphon off public funds to go to what are, in essence, private schools. How about bolstering the public schools who have sent more children to college? Those children have gone on to become our doctors, lawyers, engineers in this country and help build the infrastructure of this nation. So let's do that. And the next thing is, get them through high school. Once they're through high school, encourage them to come to the St. Philip colleges of the world, which are generally right in their neighborhood, within walking distance sometime. Let's fund these colleges. Fund the Alamo Community College. Fund it 100%, 100%. Stop fooling around. We siphon money off to go to private schools and different, they call themselves something different every year. It's a private school. So that well-heeled, wealthy people have another option and the rest of us have one less option.
Thank you. Mr. Chen, I'm going to start with you on this one. Our city parks, Southside Lions Park, Mills Pond Park, Pecan Valley, are becoming crowded, and users are parking anywhere and creating a hazard to pedestrians. What can you do about it?
We need common sense. And here in District 2, you need a representative who is going to be less worried about a $43 billion company like Uber and how well they're doing, and more concerned about our parks. When I was on council and they came to us and needed $2 million at that point, just only $2 million additional for Hartford Park, I said, well, here's what I'll need. I told the city manager, I'll need $100,000 to go to a nonprofit of my choice in District 2. Guess what? She found $200,000. And we did it. So you need that kind of political will. Not political naivete, political will and strength to say that the impetus, the importance of a district has nothing to do with how much money you make in the district, what the per capita income is, and not go down there hand in hand, but go down there as an intelligent, strong leader to represent your people.
Thank you, Mr. Diaz.
Well, those are in almost all inner city parks, so I guess just create more park area. We have a lot of vacant space that can be created into a park. I see a lot of parks being created in the expanding areas out there, like Mr. Tony already mentioned, Harvard Park, and others in the way we have it. Well, we have land in the inside area. City area could be used do the other city driveways or become another park or being too congested. Well, then the old folk will move to the other ones. We can't do much as far as, if we just have a big parking lot, then we don't have a park. So I say, just get more space to create more of a park area. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Diaz, I'm gonna start with you this time. What is your position on the state's efforts to influence what ordinance the cities can pass?
I think that's a very, very bad idea. That's very bad legislation. And especially, we have these conservatives that have dominating our Texas legislature right now. And they're the ones that say that local government, state government have more freedom. And yet here they want to deprive and spell us of that freedom that they say that they are for. So I think it's a very bad idea to take away local control by state or federal government away from the state or the state away from municipalities. Residents, constituents of local areas should have that control. If they don't want fracking, such as which is why this was created, in next to their bedroom or outside the playground of their children in school, they should have it. It's up to them. It's not up to an oil rich person that gets elected to follow laws.
Thank you. Mr. Tom?
I have a degree in government. I can tell you, as you all know, and you don't have to have that to know it's common sense. Local control is paramount to the American way of life. It always has been. And I find it very interesting, only because of my age, that I recall that some of the people who are against local control now in Austin would be 100% for states' rights. And some of us remember that buzzword. So it's just a real dichotomy to me to think that they would try to wrest local control. And it's even stranger to me that we have local representatives on city council who would acquiesce to that kind of thing. How dare they? Well, they represent us. I would never do that. We will fight to retain our local control. They want us to have local control over some things, but not others. They, being Austin, don't get to decide. Anyway, if they're so good at cleaning up someone's act, let them start with cleaning up their own act. It's sort of like asking Ray Charles to teach you to drive. I don't think it's going to work.
Thank you. Mr. Tony, we're going to start with you on this one. And I think I find this a very interesting question. So hopefully you all will listen to the question and the answer. If we had $100 million bond, why shouldn't the north side get 80% of it, since they pay the highest most taxes, or since they vote the most?
That is interesting. Brother Hall, did you grab that? you know what's interesting is that they may vote more than we do, and we're working on that. But also, you know, who goes to war to represent this nation primarily? Not from there, everyone right here. I'm telling you. Right here, your students, your children, your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews, your cousins. So no, it's about parity. We all pay taxes, we do. And again, we're gonna do away with that mindset that one's value as a citizen of this city is somehow inextricably bound to your bottom line. Your bottom line, how much you have in your checkbook. So no, that's not gonna happen. I do appreciate the question that my government guy back there asked that. He said he has to tell me. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. But no, that's not going to happen. We'll fight that. It will stop it or die trying.
Mr. Diaz?
Well, I mean, whoever put that question together, you want to take your advice and your business. Taxes are paid by all, he said, and yes, lower taxes are paid on property that's assessed lower, and I guess if you live in Alamo Heights, if you live in Manchester, you're paying higher taxes. But San Antonio also exists on sales taxes, and I think we pay more sales taxes, there's more revenue in these poor neighborhoods. If you go to any of these convenience stores, we almost, maybe two, three blocks apart. There's a lot of infusion of cash going in there. And so sales tax also goes into the city. And so, no, I don't, as Mr. Tony said, there should be some parity, some, we're not going to say, oh, everything should go to the north side simply because they are assessed at a higher property value. And yes, they do go at a higher rate at this time. So I challenge all of you, if you live within the area, and you heard that, District 9, District 10, they turn out to vote in higher numbers, so please turn out to vote.
Thank you. And just editorialize a little bit for the students here. The majority of people who vote in San Antonio are 50 plus. So basically, when you don't go to vote, you let me make decisions for what's going to happen in your life. So I would encourage you to go out and vote. And I will be happy to stay after for a little bit if anyone is not registered to vote, to help you fill out a voter registration card, which would not allow you to vote in the May 9th election, but it will allow you to vote in the runoff election that we'll definitely have in June. So next question, start with Mr. Yes, probably. I distracted myself. What will you do to curtail the number of older people losing their homes due to code violations?
That is one of the things that I've been speaking about the most, because I'm seeing this and I'm hearing this from some of my older friends that reside in District 2. Some that have already lost property, and it's mainly because of code enforcement. And yes, while the city government wants to put a good face out for and attract businesses and attract more residents to the area, we do need to take care of older people with fixed incomes that may have to move their properties and can no longer maintain them. They need to have some assistance from the city. We do have some programs and nonprofits that do help with that, but the city needs to be more involved. There needs to be more funding of that. So I would make sure, as your city council person in district, to put that in place or to work with what exists over here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We maintain a list of nonprofits in my office when I was in office, and we encourage relatives of older folks and the older folks themselves, call us. You don't have to come to City Hall. We'll come to you. Call us. We have a list of nonprofits that are looking for things to do. And many of these people are licensed and bonded, and they'll come in and they'll help with these. I just think it's a shame, and it almost amounts to an illegal land grab for the city to not assist residents who may have been paying taxes here for 40, 50 years. Now all of a sudden, they're a little older and they've got bad knees like me, and they can't get up and down the ladder, and they can't afford to cost money. You know, sometimes I think those of us who are very comfortable think that everyone's very comfortable. You know, Marie Antoinette and let them eat cake. There's no bread, let them eat cake. But everyone isn't comfortable, and they can't financially afford to call a contractor in to fix it. That's where we should step in. That's the number one thing cities should do. Keep you safe and keep you happy. If we cannot do that, and you know, any society is Judge Plato said by how it treats its children and its elderly. And we're not doing a very good job on either score right now.
Thank you, Mr. King. Oh, I'm sorry. I get confused with just two. Okay, so then we start with you because you just answered the second. What would you do to enhance veterans benefits and programs, or what can the city do?
Oh, that's a setup. Thank you, Mom.
Yeah,
I am a veteran, as I said, and the one thing we'd like to do is turn the old Good Samaritan Hospital into a full-service veteran center. That was online. When I was in office, and we were making some momentum, and I have to say, our great partner in that was St. Philip's College. And I know that there'll still be a us when I'm back in office. And we'll make that another priority, we'll make it a priority again. Somehow it has fallen by the wayside as so many things have lately. But that's number one. Not only, and again, here we go again, that we assume everybody can get into their car and drive out to the outer earth. Well, we can't. Where are most of the veterans? In areas just like this, west side, south side, some north, but not all. Many veterans are right here in District 2. There's a retired veteran right there, military officer. So they're here. It would be nice to have it close, right on the bus line. Why can't we do that? It's about priorities. All this fighting over Uber and Lyft, let's take care of the people who take care of us.
Thank you, Mr. Diaz.
I'm also a veteran who jump off the chat about it all the time. My father was a veteran in World War II, and he instilled in me that we've ever done our job, we've got faith to it. You don't need anything else. That's the mentality that I was raised with. Anyway, as far as veterans, we've seen it, it's been in the news, how they're being left behind, not paying attention to, put on waiting lists, lied to. So in San Antonio being recognized as Military City USA needs to do a better job, way better job. Whether you have people like me that don't want any credit, don't really want to say as long as I'm healthy, I don't need to be going and asking for services that others can use. It should be available to all that have already served. Because when you go out there, you're putting your life on the line for a government and country that should, at the end of your service, be there to at least provide medical services. So we can bring them locally. I work on that. Thank you.
Okay, now, Mr. Diaz, what do you think is the most important issue facing District 2 today, and how are you going to resolve it?
Well, as I always tell the possible voters, my possible voters, constituents, my other board representatives, I cannot come in with my vision and tell you what is good for you. You have to tell me what is good for you. District 2 is quite large, and it has different needs and different opportunities. Because if you start here in the downtown area, or you end up by Winters, or you end up close to Alamo Heights, each has its own interest. Now we even have over there by South Spring Road as well, which is almost country. So you have different areas with different needs. I don't want to impose my vision on any of these areas. I want to be a good district, to listen to the needs of the community, of the actual people that live there, and then be in there, move in there as quickly as possible, and provide those needs. Make sure that I, as a representative, am responsive to the needs of our community. That is what I want.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman.
I'll go back to my fraternal twins of education and employment. We need jobs here. The buzzword, of course, everyone uses, all politicians throughout, is economic development. We need jobs here, sustainable income here. And I don't mean necessarily nothing against, this is a legitimate business, nothing against pawn shops, but we've got plenty. We're okay there. We need some sustainable jobs here where we can get some people, especially some youngsters, into some training programs right here in the neighborhood. They don't have to take four buses. Right here in the neighborhood, some employment that everyone can keep and keep forever. Nothing wrong with the hotel industry. I know it funds a lot of things in this city, but what if you want more for your children or for yourself? You ought to be able to do that. So education and employment are the fraternal twins that would be the anchors of my administration.
Thank you. And this is going to be a follow-on question, but we're starting with you. President Obama once mentioned community colleges should be free, and we should work on this issue. Is there anything that the city can do to propose a solution to help the community colleges being tuition-free?
Oh, yes, the city can. The number one thing is the city can go up and shake Austin up and shake some sense into them to say, listen, it benefits the state of Texas. Statistically, 80% of the people who graduate from community colleges will stay in the state of Texas. And out of that 80%, about 60% of them will stay in their local area. So we benefit with taxes and everything else. So why do that. Yeah, we need to understand that when you're down there at the city, you all think you see fraud, waste, and abuse, but you haven't seen anything. It has to, we just need political will, the political will to get it done. There's no reason that those first 2 years shouldn't be absolutely free for every student.
Thank you, Mr. Diaz.
Well, again, as I said, Texas is, the education system is full of holes, there's a lot of problems. But it also has opportunities that during this state legislation, they're trying to kind of close some of those opportunities up, especially in-state financing for community colleges for higher education. And we should not allow that. At the city level, all we can do is take it up to Austin. Financing for us of higher education is near impossible, but we can take it up to Austin. We can try to work with programs where we can assist what already exists, such as St. Philip's and other colleges within the community college system, is to help them lessen fees and costs that are imposed on the city so that these colleges, community colleges, can succeed and keep educating our youth from here.
Thank you. Gentrification is a big issue right now, and I know there are neighborhoods in District 2 where that's in process. How can you guarantee affordable housing while neighborhoods are being revitalized? Because we certainly need to have neighbors revitalized, but where do the people who get displaced find affordable housing?
Again, these are issues, I'm glad of that question, these are issues we're confronting our community right now. You might not be sure, but it's throughout District 2. It's not just in the downtown inner city area. People in Menlo Park, because of the development, older people that are that counted on some of those homes that they bought, those properties they bought for retirement purposes, are finding it very hard to keep up with the developers moving into their areas. You have some apartments that are just right here with it, I'd say right up on the street, and new ones, and they're, I think, 100-some K, and they're right next to homes that are probably worth maybe 30,000. So it's making it impossible. We really need to, this needed to have been thought of before it was implemented. But now that it's here, we need to deal with it, and we need to deal with it in a manner that we can support those residents that are here for 50 years, some 70 years that I've talked to, the generations, help them hold on to their problems. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas.
I have proposed a program that I call Thrive at 85, and that's not 85 years old. That means if you're 60 years old and you have been an owner-occupier of your property for 25 years, so you're 60, you've owned and occupied for 25 years, 85, then your property taxes, when you hit that threshold, are frozen. They're frozen. Ad infinitum, it's over. At that rate, you will never pay a penny more. Now, that doesn't mean you decide to move to Boca Raton, Florida, and your 25-year-old grandson, who's still wage earning years, moves in. No. No. It doesn't convey to anyone in your family. But for you, it does. So if you're 75 and you've been an owner-occupier for 10 years, frozen. Because it shows that you have a commitment to the community. And let me say something else. I know that for politicians, it's easy to throw red meat out there and talk about landlords this and landlords that. Not all landlords are wealthy. We all know that. I mean, they really aren't. They're struggling too. And they're trying to make it. And they're trying to pay the property taxes. So we want to be fair to everybody. So Thrive at 85. Remember that.
Thank you. I think this is our last question. Unless somebody's got a burning question that they want to hold up while these are being answered. Let me start with Mr. Towns. Would you support higher taxes to maintain current levels of services expected by your constituents?
It's a little bit current levels of city services. I don't think we need to raise taxes to maintain, and that was to maintain current levels, not to increase, to maintain current levels. No, I don't think we need to raise taxes any more than we have. We need people to pay the fair amount. And for folks not having loopholes, that sort of thing. But no, I don't think we need to raise taxes.
Mr. Diaz?
Well, taxes, I guess it was death and taxes. So I believe that if the cost of living in Phoenix goes up, that will also go. I don't know if that's anything I can achieve. But I believe, as Mr. Tony said, that everyone needs to pay their fair share. And we have a lot of businesses that move into our country, including hotels, that get evaded taxes for the next amount of years. That I would cut out, because I believe San Antonio is a good business environment, it is. And we should not get more incentives such as abatement and put that tax burden on the residents. If we would have good corporate partners, they should come in here willing to pay their own fair share of taxes. So if we give any tax abatement, that better be a huge corporation with a lot of opportunity for local residents to get employment and good wages. Otherwise, they don't get no payment from me. They have to pay their fair share, and so the residents don't carry that burden upon their shoulders as it is today.
Thank you.
I should have read this to you before we started, but the City Council acts as the policy-making and legislative body within the city's government. Operating within the guidelines of the City Charter, the City Council appoints the City Manager, Municipal Court Judges, City Clerk, City Auditor, and members of the City's various boards and commissions. As well as having, I think all of our City Councilors have district offices to take care of the needs of their constituents. At this point, we'll start with Mr. Tony for a two-minute closing statement.
Thank you so much. I want to thank the NAACP, St. Joe's College, and St. Louis U personally, and all of you, especially the students, who came out to hear us. And the only thing I would ask you to do is hold us accountable. Hold us accountable. Don't let us get away with it. Don't let us get away with anything. Hold us accountable. That's what we work for you. So hold us accountable. When we get out there at the City Hall, sometimes it can be a little confusing. People open doors for you. You have to remember who you are, where you came from. I am, at my core, the hog farmer's grandson. That's who I am. He couldn't read or write, but he raised 14 children and sent four of them through Wilberforce University during the Depression. So I know I'm made of good stock. I care about people. My motto is service before self. And it's not just a saying, it's how I live my life. I've been blessed, and I know I've been blessed. When I was a teenager and thought that I lived so well because it was me, and my father said, "You were born on third base, and I think you hit a triple." You haven't even been up to bat, your mother and I. So that's inculcated into me. So if you send me back, y'all do like I did before. I'll do like I did before. Number one, we'll answer the phone. We'll follow up. I come myself. I can't tell you how many times, especially our elderly residents have said, "I didn't expect to see you, councilman." And I thought, that's a shame. Why not? Why not? It's a pleasure to serve people. It's a privilege. It's an honor. It's a blessing. I hope you'll give me that opportunity. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you.
As I said, I'm a lifelong resident and have seen Santa Cruz change much as I have changed from childhood to a grown man. But I grew up in public housing and in poverty situations. But always, I was taught by my grandparents, never put the hand up and greeted this not to, to actually help in building something and work. And I've done this since I was a child. Now you can say, "Well, that's child and then child labor." Those words took me to mouth growing up. And somehow I felt it was taken away from me, because then I could no longer sustain myself in that position, as I saw to my family, instead of being one that also cared alone, which I enjoyed as a child. So I became an activist early on for human civil rights, and have continued to do so. I'm also a voter registrar. I've been so for over two decades, because I believe in the power of the vote. And I see this as running for office as the next stage of development for me. I cannot keep on telling motivating people to vote when I don't run for office, because that's the next stage of development. So that's what I'm doing. I may not be the best, and I may not be the best prepared, but I will listen to you, and I will try my damnedest to take care of whatever it is that you are in need of as my constituent. You can bank on that. I've done so, and many things that I've done as an activist, I've done. I'm not planning to do. I don't want to do. I've already done it. And that doesn't mean I'm going to stop. I want to keep going. Hopefully you will elect me so I can bring this to the District 2 office, because I believe it's missing. It's a missing ingredient. That passion to do for people just simply to get things done.